So I've put a close-up version of an eye. The all of these eyes, noses and mouths, by the way, are all from this picture here. So I'll just put a reference in the corner there. I've put a close-up of the eye, but I've put it very, very faded out. The reason for that is we're just going to use that eye just for reference of size and shape. But then we'll use this one underneath when we then start to do like the shading and the colouring and the adding of the texture. So the first thing I'm going to start to do is I'm going to look at the basic shape of the eye, and I'm going to plot out some points to help to guide me of where things are. So because she's got quite a lot of sort of eyeliner mascara on there, we've got quite a smudgy top lid. We can't see that top lid very clearly. So I'm just going to take like the what I guess to be the center of that shape, and I'm just looking at where that is, and that's sort of about here, and then it comes down to a corner point, possibly about there, and I'm just going to sketch that in really lightly, and it comes down to this point here. It comes down the point of her eye there, where her tear duct is, comes down a little bit lower than the outer corner of her eye, and that holds true for most eyes. Obviously it depends on the person or the picture that you're looking at, whether they're looking straight at you or if they're looking up or if they're looking down, but we're going to talk a little bit more about that later on. So I'm now going to look at the bottom lid, and this is a little bit easier to see, and it comes about halfway down that line there, and there is a curve to that lid, but it's not quite as much as of a curve as we might think. It's a very, very soft bend up into this area here where the tear duct is. And it will look very odd at first. Like we always say, you've got to sort of trust the process and go through the ugly stage. It'll look very odd. It'll look more like some sort of weird fish than an eye. But I'm just getting the shapes in for now. I'm going to look at putting the eyelid in as well. So I'm looking at where that crosses through some of those lines. I'm just going to sketch that in quite lightly. I'm not going to draw the eyelashes or anything in at this point. This is really just, I'm using this picture just to help me judge where everything is. I'm not even worrying too much about the detail inside the inner lid. I'm just planning where everything is. And then I'm going to look at the iris and the pupil. Now, we know that the iris and the pupil are perfect circles in most eyes, in most people's eyes. They are perfect circles. They are perfectly round. But when we look at them on a photograph or on a real person, we very rarely see the whole of the circle because it's usually covered by either the upper or the lower lid. And because we can't see it all, our brain sometimes tricks us into thinking that it's more of a oval shape. Say if that's our top lid, that's our bottom lid. And it tricks us into thinking it's an oval shape. Now, it's not, because if I carried that shape on, that would make our iris like a rugby ball. And it's not. It's a perfect circle. So what I tend to do is I'll look at the line there, and then I will imagine, well, let's just carry that on. If I carried that circle on, I'm just going to zoom in a little bit, and I know roughly how big that circle's going to be, because I know the iris is there and it's in the middle. Sorry, the pupil. And it's in the middle, like that. So I know that this and that are going to be roughly the same distance to make it a nice perfect circle. And then, so I always find it really useful to do that. And then when I come down here, I draw that entire circle in. Now, I can The bottom of the circle is just hidden by that bottom lid, so it's going to be over here somewhere. The outer edge is about here. The right edge is about just less than a quarter of the way across, so it's about there. And then it comes up about there. So if I could sketch that whole circle in like that, get the pupil, which sits nicely in the middle. Again, sometimes we draw our pupils too big or too small, which can make them look like they're a bit surprised. And I'm also trying to make sure that that pupil is sitting right in the centre of that iris shape. If I look at my picture reference, there's a bit of a reflection on the pupil there, so it's distorting it a little bit. But again, there's enough clues there for me to work out where the edges of that will roughly be, and it's going to roughly be about here. And then I can always rub out the bit then that I don't need. But what that has then done is it's helped me to get these curves as accurate as possible. So it's like you're using the top of the circle to just help you to get the rest of the circle as correct as you can. That, just looking at that now, that pupil's a little bit far over to the right. Then I'm going to start looking, not at this one, because most of the shapes are all in there now. I'm going to stop looking at this one and I'm going to start looking at the one below, because this is what I want to use for my reference for all my shading, my shadows, my light areas, my dark areas, etc. So I'm going to start with what I feel is the easiest bit, which is the pupil and the iris in the center. So the pupil is very, very dark, so I like to do that bit first because that's quite straightforward. So I'm using quite a sharp pencil here. I'm just using a normal HB pencil. If you want to use like a 2B, that would be quite good also. You don't need to go any softer than that, because if you use too soft a pencil, your lines are just going to be very, very smudgy. And we want a little bit of precision in this, really. And I'm just leaving out a few little squares there for a bit of reflection, and then shading the rest of that pupil in. And then I'm going to look at the iris. So when I look at this iris here, it's very dark around the edge and it's feathering in towards the center just there. So I'm going to go around the edge with quite a heavy mark. But then when I start to shade, I'm going to remember that I want all my marks going towards that center, because then that's what's going to give me that nice feathered effect. I'm going to do some light work and then some heavier work, so I could start to feather that in. Some light work round there, but I'll probably darken that up again in a little bit because I can see there's some shadow falling on that, but I'll probably come back and do that in a second. And then some darker work. This around here, and yeah, there's lots of shadow cast on the top of that iris. It curves down here, so that's a shadow from the eyelid falling onto the iris, so I can actually just start to block that out a little bit, shade that in a little bit. Now I'm going to look at the white of the eye. Now the white of the eye is never pure white. It always has some tone to it, because again, it's part of the human body, so it'll either have like a slightly yellowish tone or a pinkish tone or whatever, or sometimes a greyish tone. It's never pure white. And if you're working from a photograph where it looks pure white, I would always suggest that you actually just put a really light touch of shading in there anyway, because that will help to make it look realistic. So on this white of the eye here, there is a very faint sort of shadow here, and then there's some smudgy shadow around the edges there as it's coming down. So I am just going to put just a very light little bit of shading in there, and I might even just give it a bit of a smudge with my finger. And you can see now, just by putting that little touch of shading onto the white of that eye, that side is starting to look a lot more realistic than that side. So now over on this side, it is much darker. There is a lot of shadow being cast on this part of the eye here. So I can really go into quite a nice bit of shading over in this section. I'm using small circular motions with my pencil just to help to sort of blend it. I'll give it a little bit of a smudge with my finger as well. And again, because this is pencil, if it goes a bit too dark too soon, we have our rubber, so that's absolutely fine. So you might want to just lift a little bit out if it's gone a little bit too dark. Sometimes it's a bit of pushing and pulling with this. It's you know, you make it dark, then you make it light again, then you make it dark, then you make it light again, until you get to a point that you're happy with it. So I am just concentrating on the eyeball, really. I'm not thinking about eyelashes or anything like that at the moment. I'm just thinking about the inner part of the eyeball itself. Okay, so I'm going to stop there and then I'll come back in a little while and I'll start doing some of the outer edges as well. But I think this would be a nice point for me to stop and for you to start thinking about having a little try of this. So if you need to borrow a pencil, pencils and rubbers are all over there on the windowsill. And I'll replay that video so that if you want to see from the start again as you're drawing, then you can. And like anything, when you've had a few minutes away from something, you might start to pick up on things that you might want to slightly alter. I'm thinking that part of it might be too dark, but I'm not sure yet, because it could be a bit of an optical illusion, because there's no eyelashes or anything there yet. The centre might just be looking too dark. So I'm going to reserve judgment on it, and I'm going to wait until I've finished all of it before I go back and start rubbing anything out. Because I suspect it could be just a little bit of an optical illusion. But it's worth noting that sometimes when you're working on something stage by stage like this, sometimes you need to sort of wait until it's all finished before you see how areas are working next to each other. So I'm going to start looking at eyelashes. Now, eyelashes are really, really tricky, because we want to draw them as what we know they are, which is individual hairs coming out of our eye. Now, on some eyes and on some photographs, you can see those individual hairs, but actually, with this one here, we can't. It is just a very dark mass of shadow all along that top lid, and then we do see a few of them feathering out, but again they're quite blurry in areas. Some are thick, some are thin. I would say I can probably see clearly maybe only 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe about 5 or 6 eyelashes there that I can see clearly. The rest is just dark sort of shadow. And that is what you need to be looking for, because our brain is quite often, it likes to trick us, because it likes an easy life, it likes to trick us into thinking, Emma, you know what eyelashes look like, just draw lots of eyelashes coming off the top of the eye. And actually, that's not what we can see. So what I'm actually going to just start to do is I'm going to hold my pencil on its edge so that I'm not right on the point. Getting on its edge, I might even create just a little bit of a tab on some scrap paper. So I'm just grinding the tip of that pencil down a little bit so I've got a nice flat edge. And I'm just going to start using soft circular sort of motions here to start to add shadow. So in the areas where I can see that it's just a mass of darkness, and that mass gets thinner as we get towards the inner corner of the eye, and thinner still, and thinner still. And it doesn't actually disappear. It goes down to here And then it goes a little bit thicker, and then it comes down to sort of a point about there. But even the tear duct itself has got quite a bit of shading in it. So I'm gonna spend a little bit of time just with my pencil, just on its edge, just blocking in some shading. So just soft shading around here. I might even hop up to the eyelid in a minute, but I don't want to get too distracted, so I'm just going to carry on just here for a minute. And that shadow actually comes down into like this area here. So I'm just going to shade a little bit of that in, and I'm going to let it just start to fade slightly at the edge, because I am going to put some bits of eyelash in there in a second. So I don't want it to have too harsh an edge. And then I'm going to look at where can I see definite eyelash looking shapes. So I can see quite a good one there, a nice meaty one there. There's a meaty sort of one here. But then in between that is just suggestions of lines. And then as I go across, let's have a look, I can see something here. It's not quite reaching up to the level of the eyelid, so I'm just keeping a check on how long I'm making these. None of them are reaching that eyelid really until we get to around here. In fact, I'm just going to draw, there's a second little crease on that eyelid that I've not put on before. And really look carefully at the angle of these eyelashes that you can see. Look at the angle that they're coming out at. Even if it helps, just put your pencil along them so that you can see the angle. And are they really curly, or do they just have a slight curve? And you'll probably find that on this one, especially on the top layer, they do just have a slight curve. Now, it looks quite odd at the minute. It looks very, very strange. And the reason for that is we're drawing dark eyelashes onto bright white paper. When we look at this eye, there's lots of shadows in that skin there, which are going to get put in shortly. So again, trust the process. Don't worry that it looks like a squished spider, because once everything else starts to go in, as long as we're sort of following the process of just drawing what we see rather than what we think it should look like, it will all start to come together. Now in this corner here, it's all just becoming a bit of a mishmash of shadow and texture. So I'm just going to leave it for the moment, I think. And I think I'm just going to, like I was saying before, I'm just going to jump up to this crease here, and I'm just going to do it as a very soft bit of shading. It is quite a defined line, but I don't want to do it as a really sharp line. I want it to look what it is, which is just a shadow in the skin. It's a crease, and so as that crease comes out and into more of a fold of skin, all that happens is the skin will just get a little bit lighter. So I'm just shading in that slightly lighter skin, going back in and just bringing out that crease again, that slightly lighter skin. I'm going to extend that shading out now to the fold of skin just above the eyelid. And I'm just looking all the time at where does the skin look lighter, where does it look slightly darker. There's like a nice sort of patch of slightly darker skin just there, which I just need to then bring that back in a little bit more. I'm going to come back over, just make sure I've got my tab. I'm going to come back over to here, and I'm just going to start just shading almost a bit like when we do like a base layer of shading on something before we start to put any detail in. I'm just going to put a base layer of shading just over here. Give it a bit of a smudge so that we don't see the lines quite so much. And then just look at where it needs to go, maybe a little bit darker. In fact, all over it needs to go darker. All over. If you're not sure about the tonal value, so whether it needs to go lighter or darker, try this. If I fold this here, hold it next to it, it's a lot darker than you think. So I'm not worried about going too dark with my shading. I am just a bit concerned that I don't want to see lines in my shading, so I'm altering the direction of my pencil, I'm giving it a smudge with my finger, I'm going to get some more of this in over here. This needs, this shadow I can work back into even more in a little while. There's all more that could be done on that, but for now I've got the bases in there. Now I'm going to start looking at the bottom lid of the eye. So the bottom lid is very different. We can see the waterline in that bottom lid. So that is the little bit of the inside of the eyelid, just there between the eyeball and where the eyelashes start to come out. Little waterline there. So I'm just putting a little bit of that waterline in, but some of it is a little bit hidden with shadow. And shall I shade it or do eyelashes first? I'll do eyelashes first. So the eyelashes start as a irregular sort of line, like a dark sort of line under here, which then a few lashes are growing out of, just like this. So I'm looking at how big are they, what direction are they going in, are they all the same? I'm trying to make them look irregular. The one thing that makes eyelashes look fake is when they're too regular. So I'm trying to get them pointing in slightly different directions. Try to get them pointed in slightly different directions, and I'm also looking at the fact that they get smaller as they get closer towards the centre of the eye until they actually completely disappear. They're gone now. There's maybe one or two over here that we can see, and then I'm going to get in there with the shading again. Now the skin is actually getting lighter as it's getting towards the centre of the eye, I've noticed. It's lighter there than it is over here. So I'm just going to keep that in mind as I'm shading. And because we're wanting to think about the structure of the eye and the fact that we've got folds of skin going over the eyeball, etc., that's why it's important that when we're learning to draw eyes, we're actually including the skin around the eye as well. Rather than just drawing a floating eye all just on its own, the skin around it, I often find, is almost the hardest bit. Once you've practiced eyes enough and you sort of know how they work, it's the shading around it that often trips us up when we are drawing. So I can see that there's lots more tonal work that I can be doing here around the side of the bridge of the nose, but I'll do that in a moment. I'm going to stop talking. So I'm just now that I've put some shading in there, there are areas that I did at first, some of the really, really dark areas that I can really start to now enhance even more because I can see. And that centre of the eye wasn't too dark after all. Now that I've got everything else around it, I can see actually it fits in just fine. Maybe I might just highlight a little bit of the white of the eye just there, but I think that's all it probably needs. Okay, so like before, I'll replay this again. If you finish your eye nice and quickly and you want to have a go at some other nice expressive eyes, then obviously you've got that sheet there and you can have a go on the white paper. Okie dokie. So now I'm going to have a go at the lips, and just as before, I'm using the image above to help me to plot out the main
points of the shapes. So I'm just dropping a line down from the corner of the mouth, and the centre line where the top and the bottom lips meet is probably the most important bit, because that is the only really clear line that we will see. The top of the lip and the bottom of the lip is more of a subtle change in tone. But this, if we put this first line in accurately, then the rest can sort of build around it. So the line that goes in between the two lips goes right out to the corners of the mouth. And then what I'm just doing here is using the grid to just, again, help me to judge where some of the key points are and where they fall in terms of the top lip and the bottom lip. Now, as we draw the top lip in, I'm doing it really, really faint because I don't want the line to be seen afterwards. I want it to just be, because all the lip is really is just a darker skin tone. So we want to try and avoid having an outline around the edge of it. I'm also just very subtly just fading that line out before it meets the corner of the mouth, because it doesn't go right to the corner in a solid line. It just sort of disappears. And you'll notice that the bottom lip is nice and full and rounded. And then the top lip, you can almost imagine two sort of rounded shapes to help make that top lip nice and full. Now, I don't need those shapes in the actual drawing. I was just to illustrate the fullness of the lips. So I've rubbed those out and now I'm just starting to put in my darkest tones. So I'm looking now at the picture below because I've got the shapes and I'm looking at the tones. So I'm looking at the more detailed tonal picture underneath. So I'm going along that central line first of all. I'm looking at where the line is thicker and thinner. In the corner of the mouth we've got quite a almost like a smudgy rounded area of shadow. So I'm looking at where the line thickens and then thins out again, where the very dark line perhaps has a few little irregularities in it, where it maybe is a little bit more irregular, and also starts to spread out into small little crease lines coming up the top lip. Now, because the lips are rounded, we want to try and remember that when we draw any little creases or shadows into those lips, we want the lines to follow the contours of the lips, which is illustrated on one of your handouts, but you'll also see when I start to shade it. Now, naturally, when you draw lips, the top lip is usually slightly darker than the bottom lip. That's because of the angle that it curves and the light not quite hitting the top lip as much as it does the fuller bottom lip. And you can see that this photograph that we're working from follows that rule. If you find it difficult to distinguish between the different tones, then maybe just squint your eyes slightly when you look at the picture and you will notice that the top lip is slightly darker than the bottom lip. The bottom lip has some nice shiny highlights on it too, which we can make sure we pop in with a rubber at the end. So I've just put a mid-tone on that top lip and now I'm just going over it with just a little bit more detail, looking at where some of the areas are slightly darker. I'm using a rounded mark with my pencil just to keep it nice and smudgy, but I am occasionally smudging it with my finger, or you can do that with a blending stick as well. It's these very subtle changes in tone that will start to make the lip look a little bit more realistic. So do pay attention and spend some time on that. Now, it's difficult to draw the lips without looking at the skin around the lips too, because that the contours of the skin around the lips is what will help to give the lips more of a realistic look. So in most cases you will find a shadow underneath the bottom lip, which again gives that bottom lip its form. It makes it sort of come forward in the drawing, to pop forward. And you'll see also that the curve of the chin is just starting to appear on this particular drawing, just in the form of a little highlight underneath. So by putting that shadow in under the lip and the shadows that drop just from the corners of the mouth, it again just gives the mouth some context and helps to make it look more realistic. You'll see in a moment that I'm going to turn the drawing upside down. Number one, it helps with, you know, the angles of, you know, the way that you're shading, but also it helps to double check any areas that you think, you know, oh, I need to work more on that, or that needs to be darker, that needs to be lighter. Turning it upside down just gives you that that opportunity to notice any of those things that might need a little bit of work on. So here I'm spending a little bit of time on the highlights and mid-tones in the centre of that lip there to really start to make it look quite plump and shiny. So a little bit of shadow towards the bottom, a few little bits of texture and creases coming up from the edge, and then we'll be using a rubber to add a little bit of highlight to here and there. There's also a little bit of shadow above the top lip, so there's like a tiny white sort of gap, almost like where the skin is sort of still a little bit plump over the top of the Cupid's bow, but then it goes slightly darker again as the skin starts to recede slightly as it moves up towards the nose. So that's why I've just popped a little bit of shadow in there as well. And then we can use the rubber just to add some of the highlights on there, just to start to bring some of those lighter areas forward. And then just as a finishing touch on the lips, what I was talking about before with the contour lines, I'm just popping in a few more of these curved contour lines, just very, very lightly, just to suggest when you're looking at it, that that 3D rounded form of that bottom lip. It just really makes it really obvious to you when you're looking at it that it's curved and it's rounded when you've got those little soft lines in there. So now I'm going to start to look at the nose, and I'm just starting to put some straight lines in to help to define the outline shape of the nose, and I'm doing it really, really lightly because I really do not want these lines to show up. But what I'm doing is I'm just almost sort of mapping out the angle of the curve at the side of the nose, how it curves down underneath the nostril, and by using the grid to help me judge where those lines sit, it just helps me to get the nose the right size and shape. I'm looking now at the circle of the point of the nose. So I just drew that circle in and then moved over and just tried to replicate it as best I could on that right hand side. And then I'm looking at the highlight that goes from the tip of the nose up to the bridge of the nose. So it's almost like a narrow triangle. And then we've got the forehead down the bridge of the nose is an inverted triangle the other way round. So it's like I'm breaking it up into simple shapes and structures. I'm using just a thin line there to help me to judge where the nostrils sit. So there's no sort of measuring or anything here, or any sort of rules or tricks. I'm literally just looking at the picture and using the structure that I see on the picture and copying it over onto that other side to help me almost carve it out. Now, those lines are really, really faint. If at this point you think the lines are a bit too dark, you want to lighten them up with your rubber a little bit, because when we start to shade this, we don't want those lines to be visible. Now, I've turned the picture upside down for the shading part. I find a lot of the time turning a picture upside down helps, but I particularly like doing it with noses, because noses are, I think, the trickiest thing to draw. Because there's very few definite lines on the nose, it's all done with smoke and mirrors. It's all done with like shadows and very subtle changes in tone. So by doing it upside down, it really makes us look at where we can see those shadows and changes in tone. Now, I'm doing the nostrils first because I think they're the easiest bit to do, because I'm just looking at the shape that I can see and where it sits and just shading that in, and it gives me a good starting point. And now I'm looking at the shadow around the left hand side of the nose there, and I'm just using really light soft circular motions with my pencil. I've created a tab on the pencil first so that it isn't too scratchy, it's still quite soft, and I'm just looking at where I can start to just plot in some shadows. Now, there's a curved shadow just underneath the tip of the nose there between the two nostrils. There's a little bit of shadow down the left hand side of the rounded tip. There's actually a little bit of shadow on the right hand side too, but not as much. And then there's tiny little bits of shadow underneath the nostrils as well that are giving the skin that shape. So we're basically trying to trick the eye into thinking that we've got, you know, skin on this page here, by just creating light and dark areas to sort of trying to bring it out from the paper a little bit. So I'm just working my way around the nose, looking at where I can see blocks of shadows. Now, down the left-hand side of this nose, there's a nice sort of big triangular chunk of shadow. It's not particularly dark, so I'm starting really light with it at first. And then there's a shadow that comes down almost from the inside of the eye, down the side of the nose. So I'm thinking of it in terms of, you know, like abstract shapes, really, in a way. I'm sort of trying to forget that it's a nose and an eye that I can see, and thinking, right, what shapes can I see? How dark are they? How light are they? And how can I best just try and copy those with my pencil? So I'm doing my first layer of shadows, and then there might be some areas then that I look at and I think, do you know what, that needs to be a little bit darker, just like this bit here, just underneath the nose, because it's a much darker shadow than some of the others on that particular picture, but it was starting to look very similar. So you will need to go back and revisit some of your shadows as you go along, as they start to, you know, you think, ah, it looks too similar to that one, it needs to go a little bit darker. Now, this is definitely one of those techniques where you just have to try and trust the process, because it looks, like I say, very abstract at the moment. But when you eventually turn this round in a few minutes' time, you will see that it is starting to look a bit more human. So now on the second exercise sheet, we've got a full face that we can start to look at. So I'm using the exact same techniques that I did on the individual eyes, nose and mouth. And I'm using the grid to help me plot those out. But then I'm going to use the more contrasty black and white picture on the right to help me with details and shadows afterwards. So just like I did on the previous nose, I'm drawing in the structure of the nose, you know, the rounded point, some straight lines just to show me where the outside edges of the nose are and where they sit amongst that grid pattern. So a little line underneath where the bottom of the nose is. Just going to curve those in slightly. Did it really lightly because I don't want these lines to show up on my drawing. And then that gives me a better idea of where I think those nostrils are going to sit. So I'm not going to talk through all of this now because I'll just be repeating myself from the previous exercises. But as you watch, you'll be able to see that I am drawing them using the same techniques as the three practice ones we've previously done. So on the final page of your handout, I gave you four portrait photos that you could use to have a go at doing a portrait of your own. I'm going to put a grid onto this picture, and I'm going to do a slightly different grid. For those of you who haven't seen this before, this is a great way, different type of grid that you can use if you've not got a ruler, because you can just use a straight edge, like I'm using an edge of a piece of paper here. So what I did first of all was I just drew two diagonal lines from corner to corner to make a cross across the picture. That then helps me find the centre of the picture, and then through the centre of that picture I drew a vertical and a horizontal line. So it makes almost like a union flag line across the centre. And then each of the four quarters I'm going to divide up again using a diagonal line. So I'm just going from corner to corner. So you end up with a series of diamond shapes on your picture. Now I'm going to draw this onto a piece of A5 paper. So the paper I'm going to be drawing on is bigger than the original photograph, but that's fine. And I'm going to do the same grid onto the plain paper as well. So you'll see here how that grid again works, and I'll talk you through it for a second time. So again, all you need is something straight to draw against. If you've not got a ruler, anything with a straight edge, like another piece of paper or anything like that, works really well. So I'm just dividing my paper up here because I'm just going to use half of this piece of paper. So I'm just going to be using the right-hand side of the piece of paper. So start off by drawing diagonal lines from corner to corner on the paper. So left to right and then right to left. So this is exactly the same as what I did on the photograph. And then that gives me a central point, which I can then line up and do a vertical line. I'm working on a very small desk today, so I'm having to move things out of the way. And then I can put a line going across the other way. So you can see there how that has made the Union flag design. And then each of the four quarters, I'm just going to do another corner to corner in each of the four quarters. So I end up with a set of diamond shapes. It's almost like, it should look like at the end, like you've divided your picture into four, and then each of the four quarters has got an X in it. That's what it should look like. So now those grid lines are going to be used as reference points for me now to start to put in the main shapes of my drawing. So I'm going to speed up the video a little bit, but I will talk you through some of the main parts that I think are relevant as we go through. So at the moment I'm just looking at the main outline of his head and face. So I'm looking at the cheekbones, the jawline, down to the chin, and I'm using those grid lines as reference points to help me just to check that I've got things in the right place. I'm not worrying at the moment about sort of the hairline, you know, where the hair meets the forehead or anything like that, just the rough outline. And then what I'm doing here, if you can see, is I just looked at a line. If I imagined a straight line going through the corners of both of his eyes, and I drew that on the photograph. Now I'm looking at the halfway line between his eyes, just to help me to judge roughly where his nose should be. And I was looking at where the rounded point of his nose is, and then the rounded curve of the side of his nose. So it'll look quite robotic at first, and now just plotting in, looking at where the corner of his eyes are, and I'm looking really carefully at the curvature of the upper and lower lids of his eyes. His eyes are not only looking to the side, but they're also slightly closed, and we are looking at him from slightly above. So his top lid of his eye is actually quite straight, but for a very sort of soft curve at the edge. I've drawn the irises and the pupils of the eyes as an ellipse, so that means they are slightly oblong. Again, because they're looking to the side, they're not looking straight at us, so they will be an oblong shape, like a slightly squished circle. And I've drawn them over the upper and lower lids, like I talked about before when I was drawing the previous eyes. Now I'm starting to look at his mouth, and I'm just using the grid to help me to plot where the corner of his mouth is, and I'm using other things to help me to line that up too, like where does it sit in relation to his nose, where does it sit in relation to his eye. You know, if I was to drop a vertical line down from his eye to the corner of his mouth, what would it line up with? Just to help me get the right sort of size. And you'll see with the mouth, I did the line in between the lips first, and then the lips will probably need a little bit of looking at, because they're not quite the right shape at first. You'll see me doing a little bit of tweaking with that afterwards. Now I am starting to look a little bit at the hairline. So the hairline of where his beard is sitting on his face, and the general shape of that and how that goes around his face. Again, it looks a little bit robotic at the moment, but that will soften up once we start to shade it in. Really, all these lines are for now is to just help us to map everything out, really, before we start putting any real effort into detail. And then it's at this point that we can start to look at, do we feel like the proportions are right? Does anything need majorly changing or tweaking? You could put the pictures upside down to look at them if you want to help you with that. Sometimes just taking a little break and going away from it for a little while helps with that too, because you notice things straight away sometimes when you've had a little break. Now here I'm just using my rubber to take away the guidelines now, because I feel like things are more or less there. I don't think I need the guidelines anymore. So I'm just using my new favourite toy, my little electric rubber, just to take some of those fine lines away. So now I'm starting to add some shade to the eyes, and I'm doing it exactly the same as I did with the eyes previously. I'm looking at the centres of the eyes first, and then putting a little bit of shading around the lower lid and the upper lid, making sure I'm putting that eyelid crease in there as well. But I'm also just paying attention to shadows. So where I can see that the skin above or below the eye is slightly shaded, I'm just popping that in all at the same time. There are some bits that I'm leaving out, and I'll go back to do those at a later date, but that's just the way I work. I sort of work quite quickly, and I hop from one thing to another thing, rather than spending like an hour on the eyes until they're perfect, then an hour on the nose until that's perfect. I like to just get them good enough and then move on to something else, and that's good enough, and then something else, and then go back and revisit and add to or take away if I need to. So it's like an ongoing process of tweaking and shaping and adding to. Here I'm just looking at the nose, and I'm looking at where, you know, go for the easy wins first. You know, where can I see a really nice dark bit of shadow I can pop in? Like there, I could see just a little bit of something under the nose, and I could see a bit of shadow around the curve of the side of the nose. So I thought, right, well, I'll put that in. And then I could see a nice shadow under the nose as it's leading into his moustache. So I thought, right, well, I'll just pop that in there. There are some areas that I think needs just to be lightened up, or some guidelines to be taken away as I go along. So I can rub those out and tweak those as they go along. And then there might be some little areas of shadow on the nose that I can just pop in while I'm looking at it. So just along the left-hand side of the bridge of the nose. And then there's actually a narrow triangular shadow there just on the right, which I can just start to lightly put in. Again, it might not be perfect straight away, but I'm happy to just start to build that up to then go back to it at a later point. Now I'm going to start to look at the right eye. Now, eyes that are looking sideways are really tricky because we have to almost forget everything that we've learned so far about eyes. You know, the curve of the upper lid and the curve of the lower lid, and the fact that the iris and the pupil are perfect circles, because when they're looking sideways, they're not. They're pointing away from us, so they aren't perfect circles. So this is where your observation skills and looking at that photograph really clearly will come in. Because the eye is a lot smaller than the practice ones we've done, you can't get quite as much detail in. So for eyelashes, for example, you'll notice when I'm doing the eyelashes on the lower lid, I'm literally just putting little dots in there. Little lost and found little dots, just to give that suggestion of there being eyelashes there, because you can't really see them on the photograph, but we want to just give an impression of them being there. And again, to help make that eye look realistic, I'm getting in some of those shadows. So I'm looking at that shadow between the eye and the eyebrow. So if you think about the structure of the face, which is what we've talked about during the lesson, if you think your eye is sitting in an eye socket, and above our eye socket we have our brow bone. So the brow bone juts out further than our eye, and that is why on most faces when you're drawing them, you need to have that shadow under the eyebrow. And that is why makeup evolved for us to put eyeshadow on, because that accentuates that sunken eye and the prominent brow. The shadow accentuates that. So here, this guy, he's obviously not wearing any makeup, but you'll see that there are shadows where normally eye makeup would go. So now I'm having a look at the mouth, and I know that the mouth isn't quite right. I've got the curve of the Cupid's bow the wrong way around, because the left side of it is actually slightly higher than the right side, and I'd drawn it the opposite way around. I'd drawn the right side higher than the left. So I've had just a little rethink of that and a change of that. It's also just slightly more curved at the edge, so I've just changed that, and I'm just going to shade that in a medium dark tone, slightly lighter in the middle of the lip because it is on the photograph, and just going to use my rubber just to help me with that. And then the bottom lip, when I start to look at that, again, is much lighter than the top lip, but there are shadows towards the left, the right, and just the underneath. And as soon as I start to get some of those shadows in that I can see on the photograph, it just starts to come together. Looks a bit odd at the moment because he's got a beard that we haven't shaded in yet. So you just, again, I know I always say you've got to trust the process. Just go with it and just reserve judgment until you have got more parts of the drawing in. Because then once you've got more parts in, you might look back at the eyes or the mouth and go, oh, actually, yeah, that's all right. Or, yeah, I can see now where it needs to change. So this is why I work in the way I do, where, you know, I don't fully finish each part methodically, because you never know, your attitude towards it might change as you get further on through the drawing. So I just sort of half finish it and then go around and do something else and then come back and see what else needs doing on it. So I'm just starting to put a little bit of tone in now, just at the very sort of almost the first, I don't know, the first coat, the first layer for the beard. I'm putting a very, very wiggly, soft, broken line in for the edge of the beard, because we can see it's not obviously a solid straight line. We see some little individual growth of hairs. So you'll see here I'm using my rubber to rub out parts of that straight line that I initially drew, and then using very sort of wibbly wobbly broken sort of lines to start to just give me an outline for that beard. And I will do the same over the edge of the hairline on the top of the head as well in a moment. I'm just starting now to look at a little bit of shadow on the structure of the skull. So you can see there at the right hand side of the temples, we've got a lovely area of shadow, and there's one on the left hand side too. So I can start to put a little bit of that in with my pencil, really lightly, knowing that I'll probably go back and make it darker later, but it just gets it started, gets it going. And then I'll look for any other areas on the face, thinking about the structure of that skull. So where we've got the side of the skull, we've got a shadow there just underneath where the cheekbone is, which gives us almost a triangle of light underneath the eye. And then over on the left hand side, we can really start to go to town a little bit more with the shadows, because it is darker on the left hand side than it is on the right. Now here you can see I'm just getting rid of that solid outline on the hairline, and with my pencil, again, just going in there with a very, very broken, wiggly line, just to try and emulate the very soft sort of baby hairs on the hairline, where you can see a little bit of hair growth on either side. So I'm going to show you a little bit about how I would start to shade in the hair, because the hair on this photograph, as we see it, is very solid. We can't see any individual hairs or individual highlights, etc. But we know that they're there. So as you can see, and I've just skipped forward just a little bit, I just did, had my pencil on its side, and I just started to use a scumbling technique with my pencil to shade over the darkest areas of the beard, and then making sure that I was getting them a little bit softer at the edges. Now you'll see this technique again now as I just do the moustache. So I'm using very soft scumbling, almost scribbly marks with my pencil, because I just want it to look quite natural and irregular, as, you know, facial hairs do. They don't all look perfectly straight or perfectly regular. And as we get around the left hand side of his mouth, we can see that it's much, much darker, and the hair is mingling with the shadows that are cast from the nose and the mouth. So I can sort of blend those in and start to add to some of those shadows where they're needed. And then I can go down the side of the face and start to go under that chin and start to build in some of the facial hair under the chin to go round to meet the bit that I've already drawn. So I'm going over layer by layer, just darker and darker, just to gradually build that up. Now the left hand side of the face is darker than the right hand side of the face, so I'll be paying a little bit more attention to some of those light and dark shadows in a moment. Just looking at, as I was drawing, I was noticing some areas of his eyes that needed a little bit more defining. So you'll see things, you'll notice things as you're drawing that need a bit more attention. I'm building up some extra tone and shadow on his forehead and his temples now. It was looking a little bit flat, so I just needed to build that up a little bit more. You'll notice the tone there, just above his left eye. Directly above his eyebrow, it's quite light, and then it goes a little bit darker. We get that on our skulls. It's part of our brow bone. So our brow bone above our eyebrow sticks out just that little bit further. And that's why it will always just appear a little bit lighter above the eyebrow before it then... before you get a little bit of shadow on there. Now you can see that's the left cheek here is really starting to build up some tone now. It's starting to get darker, therefore it will start to recede in the picture. That means to go backwards. So again, that will help it to look 3D because he is looking to one side, which means the left-hand side of his face is further away from us than the right-hand side of his face. Now, in a minute or two, this video is going to skip ahead because I did the hair in a very similar technique than I did to how I did the beard. So with the scumbling technique of the pencil and then going over it in layers to build up the density of the colour. So I did that off camera and then came back, but it will look like I've done more work on the face, and I wanted to point this out because I hadn't done any more work on the face. It's just that putting the hair in and starting to finish the beard off just made the face look more finished too, which is what I always say about, you know, just reserve judgment on your drawing until you've worked on all of the different parts of it. So just a couple of seconds and you'll see the video will skip forward and you'll see the difference. So here we go. So I finished his hair off here. So as you can see, did quite heavy shading on the hair, and then very sort of scumbly, quite sort of scribbly little outlines around the hairline to try and fade that into the skin. I'm just looking at the ear now. Ears are quite tricky, so again, just look at what shapes and shadows you can see. Rather than trying to draw an ear shape in inverted commas, because what we see there is not an ear shape. It's not the traditional, you know, what we think an ear looks like. It is literally folded bits of skin on the side of someone's head. So we need to look really carefully at where those folds are, how big are they, where are they dark, where are they light, and just start to shade those in. And then your brain fills in the rest. When you look at that picture, your brain will look at it and go, oh yeah, that's an ear. So as you can see there, taken out of context, if I just showed you that ear, just that little part of the drawing, you might not necessarily know what it is. But in context, as part of the portrait, it's absolutely fine. I'm just using my rubber there to just lift out a few highlights because there are some very, very light areas. This particular portrait, you can see it's lit from the right-hand side. So that ear has got some very light areas on it. And I'm using my rubber here just to add a little bit of texture to the hair. Because in the photo, I can see just a few very, very tiny little highlights where the light is hitting his hair. So I've put a few dots in with my rubber, but then smudged it back over again. Because I don't want it to look like, you know, he's been out in the snow. I just wanted to have some tiny little pinpricks of highlights in the hair. So I smudged some bits and then smudged it with my finger afterwards. So here I'm just looking at where I can lift some highlights out on the skin. You know, where are there some highlights on the forehead, maybe down the nose, under the eyes, above the eyes, on the lips, etc. Just for finishing touches. And it really is, like I say, just for finishing touches. There's not much else I'm going to do on this particular portrait now. So I'm looking at where the light has hit, especially around the eye. If we pay attention to the eyes on a portrait, you can get away with a lot elsewhere if you really pay attention to the eyes. That's where you get the lightness, that's where you get the expressiveness. So, along with the link to this video, you should have also been sent the handouts that have got the practice sheets on as well. So if you can print those at home, fantastic. If you can't, let me know and I will get some to you. I've got some copies here so I can get those to you and so you can have some practices of your own. But please let me know how you get on and please let me know if you're struggling, if you need any more help. Okay, speak to you soon.